hard enough to get around the school fence that day, you know? Yeah, good spot. Really spot. I'm going to go to the next one. But now, 7 o'clock, right here, come along. We'd love to have so many people praying for the year and kicking off the year. This is the first prayer meeting of the year, so we'd love to have everybody into that and get everything working around that. So it's fantastic. A vital part of the church life, just like it's a vital part of your life, then your spiritual walk's on fire, you know, your life is on fire. When you're in churches like that, there's a spiritual passion going on the place, and it erupts and it's contagious through the place. So I'd love to come for that. Hey, the big thing though is the Disciple Makers Search and Rescue Conference. Come on. Now that's happening in about 10 days. And so if you have not confirmed that you are coming, you need to come and see us and make sure you get one of those tickets before they're all gone or seconded or whatever happens to them. So we need to make sure we're getting in there or sold out. The conference itself is sold out. If you want to buy a ticket yourself, it's going to cost you, I think, $105 for a regular entry. We'll get it to you for $59, I think it is, or $51, or something stupid. Something ridiculous. I should be putting another $10 on it, maybe a cup. But we're not. But you can still get those at a very cheap accommodation. So we want to make sure we get as many people as we can to that. That is going to be worth 6 months of discipleship, is what I always say, in your world. And that is just absolutely priceless. You know, so come along to that. Way too much fun, ridiculous amount of fun. And so that's going to be happening all those days, which is fantastic. Do I have anything else? Other than baptism coming up, I'll give you that. Other than baptism coming up, if you want to get baptized, I think we've got about half a dozen names, I think, at this point, for people getting baptized. So which is fantastic. And I'm just toying with the idea of putting a pool right here and just how we can do that. And I love to mess up services. I just love it. It's kind of my thing. And I think this is a great way. I don't think a pool right here would be quite cool. We just get it cranking. Who cares if the floor doesn't hold? Minor details. It's overrated, all that sort of stuff. Silly stuff. Hey, we're going to come to the offering. Let me just get back to my photo of my verse. And there it is. And I'm going to talk to you from a very familiar passage, Malachi chapter 3, which is actually, for many people, the tithe passage, Malachi chapter 3 is a go-to verse. For me, it is not a go-to verse. I tend to go, if I'm going to teach on something to do with finances, even to do with the tithe, even though this is one of the clearest statements about the tithe, it is not my go-to message. And simply because I've heard it so often, and I know you have. So when I was praying about an offering message a couple of weeks ago, God sort of showed me this passage again and with a really fresh view. And so I'm just going to read to you one verse, verse 10. It says here, "Bring all the tithes into the storehouse so there'll be enough food in my temple. If you do so, the Lord of heaven's army, I will open up the windows of heaven for you. I will pour out a blessing so great you won't have enough room to take it in." Everybody say, "Won't have enough room." Now here's the thing we're getting to. You won't have enough room to take it in. Try me. Put me to the test. Your crops will be abundant, for I will guard them from insects and disease. Your grapes will be ripe, and so goes on, says the Lord of the armies of heaven. Now, the context of this is people farming, and God's talking to them about how he's going to bless their crops. Okay? So God's going to bless their crops. He's going to come out and say, "Look, your crops are going to get so much that you cannot contain them. You will not have enough room." So picture a farm with wheat in the field, a big silo. You know, and if we're looking at a typical farm, we've got a big one. You know, there's this big massive silo sitting there, and that's where they're going to store up their grain. And that's going to be the place for their storage. And God said to them that when you bring this message to me, when you bring your tithe to me, what I'm going to do is I'm going to fill up this silo that is here to the ceiling high. I'm going to fill it up, and you're not going to have enough to contain it. So you're going to be finding that at that point, it's going to be overflowing. You're going to go get the ladder out, put some more down, jump in, squash it down, press it down as much as you can, because this thing, we've got to try and get more in it. We've got to think. Now, this leads me to this thought that right here, we have a climate of limitation. Upon this person's world, upon this farm, they've got a limitation as to how much blessing from God they can contain. The problem is not how much blessing God wants to pour out.
He's going to pour out more blessing than they can put in their silo. Their silo's chucked to the top, and that's all I've got. But I was thinking, God, what, how does this work for us? Because every single person has a limitation, a climate of limitation upon the world, that when you come to God, there's only so much that you can receive. And so somehow we have to begin to get our thinking, get our heart, get our spirit into a place where we can say, man, I can receive more from God. How many think that's a smart place to be? So I was thinking, God, what is this? What is this place? How do we adjust ourselves so that we can receive more from God when He's wanting to bring stuff to us? Now, the first one is obviously faith. It's obviously a position of faith. You have to believe that God actually wants to do this for you. If you don't even, if you look at the scriptures like this saying, bring the tithe into the storehouse, and you look and go, that's not for me, it's for somebody else, and you push it to a side, or you say, hey, maybe it's for another time, then you probably need to adjust that. You probably need to adjust some thinking on the inside of you, because immediately you've not only discounted a responsibility, but you've discounted a blessing. And so you've limited, you put limitation or kind of a limitation around your spirit. The second thing was I was seeing was the climate of the atmosphere of obedience. So faith and obedience. Now, obedience is a bizarre thing. Because right through Scripture, whenever you see obedience, you don't necessarily see it as obedience to the thing to which they are doing. So I'm doing something. Have a look. The guy, the soldier, he's got leprosy. The captain of the Philistine armies has leprosy. And he goes to a prophet and he says, go and dip in the Jordan River 7 times. He says, dip, I've got leprosy. He says, dip in a river, yeah, that's one thing, but why in a scurvy river in Israel when I can do it in my own country? You know, what's the deal with this? What is dipping in a river going to do for me anyway? It's not going to do anything. One of his advisors says, hey, look, if they told you to do something great, would you do it? He says, yeah, I would. Well, go and do the simple thing. This is a simple thing. So he goes off to a river, and he comes up to the river, and then he dips it 7 times. On the 7th time, he comes up, and his leprosy is gone. And he's realizing a principle right there, that sometimes your victory and sometimes your blessing is wrapped up in your obedience. But sometimes your obedience is to something that looks entirely different to the thing that you're aiming for. So sometimes we'll come and we look at it and say, God, you can do stuff in my world any way you want to. But God says, how about a tithe? How about a tithe? How about you bring this and see that I will not pour out something in your world. And instantly, when you begin to do this, when you begin to buy in, you begin to say, God, I'm doing this because I'm going to follow through with my obedience. What you begin to do is you begin to enlarge your capacity to receive from God. Before you get this, you don't have a capacity that's big enough to contain all that God has. And you still don't. But we need to enlarge all the time. Begin to think bigger, dream bigger. But half of it is always tied up in obedience. There's always an element of obedience where somehow we have to align ourselves and say, God, I'm going to do the thing that you want me to do. Does that sound good? Anybody get something out of that next morning? Father, we just pray as we pass these along, Father, that as this tithe going in, Father, that you would increase the ability and the capacity, that the climate of limitation, Father, would be broken on people's worlds, and Father, blessing and abundance would come into the world so much that they cannot contain it in Jesus' name. Everybody say it? Amen. Amen. Fantastic. I'm going to hand back to Dan right now. Sorry, guys. I'm going to interrupt one more thing. I just interrupted myself. That's good. Keep playing. That's nice. I want to do one more thing just before. Last week we prayed for a whole bunch of people getting commissioned into stuff. And one person who was away, and we want to pray for her right now. Is Cassie here? Yes, I think you are. See that hand? She didn't put it up, by the way. Come down here. I want to pray for you. Keep playing. That's good. Pray for her. Cassie is for her, and that she's going to be refreshed in doing that. Does that sound good?
come on.
Father, we just send you right here. For Cassie, just stretch out your hand right here. Father, we just come pray for Cassie. Father, she's stepping on this role, and she's doing this role so faithfully of looking after your kids and our kids down in that kids' church. Father, we pray for anointing upon her for this task, Lord God. Lord, it's not just a teaching task, but Father, it's a spiritual task. It's an impartation task. Father, it's a discipling task. Lord, it's all of these things. Father, we just pray that you would bless. Bless her with a great team about her. Bless her with great insight, great revelations. Father, great ways to break into the heart of hearts and the kids who don't understand. Father, that they might be soft hearts before you. Father, we just pray that you'd commission, Lord God, and we commission, Lord, right here in Jesus' name. Father, anointing right here, Father, in Jesus' name, we pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. And everybody say it. Amen. Amen.
Oh,
lift you up, we glorify you. We magnify your name. Lord, we see you lifted up in our world. We see you lifted up in our hearts. Lord, in our worship. Lord, we're seeing you represented by the lifting of hands and the worship and the praise. Father, we honor you here in this place. And Father, we know that you want to intervene in the hearts and the lives of your people. And so, Father, with this in mind, Father, we turn this place into a prayer meeting for just a few moments. And Father, we lift up these prayer meetings represented in these prayer cards. Father, we lift up the prayer meetings represented in each heart of our congregation. Father, the needs that we know about our community, Father, we ask for a divine intervention. Father, we ask that you would break through in a divine manner that only you can do it. Father, bring in finance, bring in healing, bring in miracles in Jesus' name. Father, break through, break through, break through in Jesus' name.
Will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Do you love how you're just even reading the verses? And God knows first time around when someone's listening, so he even repeats them the next one's down, just rewording it, but the same thing. Anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like useless branches and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile to be burned. But if you remain in me and my word remains in you, you may ask for anything you want and it will be granted. When you produce much fruit, you are my true disciple. This brings great glory to my Father. Just want to pray. God, we thank you as we go about your word today, Lord. I thank you for the message that you have given me, Lord, and I just pray that it will just speak to people, it will speak something in there that will just ruminate in their heart, God. And I just pray that as we continue this service, Lord, we thank you that you're already here, God, and we just pray that you'll just help me to get this message across. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now, interesting enough, Kylie's at it again. Because have you ever noticed, Kylie, I wish I was a gardener, always gets inspired by scriptures that are to do with gardening. Has anyone noticed that? It's like all the time at the moment. I'm like, man, I really should get in the garden. And, you know, Nick's been talking about planting seeds intentionally this year, not by chance. And we've been, you know, going over that the last month maybe, and stuff. But let's continue to pray for our wild goals and dreams. And don't give up, because it's in God's time and not yours. And, you know, like, if you want potatoes for tea tomorrow night, fresh potatoes just going out of the garden, you're not going to go and plant them today. Because who knows that by tomorrow, if you go and pull them out, you're not going to even see a change. And, you know, things take time. You plant them, then you water. You don't even have to water your garden this summer, it's so good. Wait. Then you wait. Then we wait. Then if it's been a sunny day, it's going to be the day of time. Then we can water it. Then we wait. Are you getting the picture here? Wait. Good things take time. Isn't that what the saying says? But you know, what are you doing in that waiting? Are you giving up? Or are you carrying on? And sometimes you think God has forgotten. And maybe you need to do something else while you're waiting. Maybe you need to keep planting more seeds. Because who knows, if you want fresh produce in your garden all year round, you have to plant all year round in season. Because you're in due season, things will re-harvest. Not everything comes to ripen at the same time of the year. That's why we get fruit and vegetables in season. So God is the same. So keep planting seeds. Keep growing in God. Keep serving in his house. Keep doing things while you wait. And I found something this week, that reminded me of a journey Nick and I had. And to be honest, it's something that I've forgotten about. Because you know how things happen in your life, and then you just carry on and you forget about the journeys you had almost. Our house. You know how we talk about the best thing of our house in New Zealand? And we did have a house in Australia before that. But this one here, my wish list that you know you guys know about, I wrote that list 6 years before we had it. 6 years. That's a long time to wait. That's a long time to trust God. But the one which is more remnant to me, and I will never forget this time, never forget, having children for us, that was a 5-year faith journey to have Elijah, which means the Lord is my God. It wasn't something that just happened. That was something we had to fight for in faith. And we even had people come alongside us, and as I've told and shared with some of you before, we even had a flatmate pray and fast so we could have children. It's like, how cool was that? And we didn't even know who was doing it, you know? And sometimes it seems a long time, but sometimes you have to keep pushing through. And sometimes the more you push, the more you fight, the better it is. How much sweeter is that reward? But the thing is, with us going through this 5 years for Elijah, we could go back to a prophecy. This is how good God is to us. And we got a prophecy in 2003. Yes, a long time ago. Don't tell me that you recorded it. And one tiny part in this awesome prophecy was the devil, this is from Pascal Pringle, by the way, in 3rd of October 2003 in Sydney, lots of thoughts. The devil will attempt to distract you with things to do with this life, things to do with property, things to do with stuff that is to do with the working of a family and the needs of your world, but the Spirit of God will say to you, focus yourself, and I will add these things to you as a consequence of you putting me first. You would have no idea how many times I had to go back to that and read that bit that said, you know, for me, stuff to do with the things to do with the family. Put God first, I will get that. And I had to cling on to that. I had to cling on to scriptures, and I had to fight to get that. And I'm not saying it was easy. I'm not saying that I was the perfect Christian in that 5 years of waiting. Because sometimes I got angry. Sometimes I had a little throw my toys out of the pot. You know, sometimes I was just absolutely ridiculous. Probably because the occasion was on too. But you know what I mean? But you throw your toys out, and then what do you have to do? Pick them all up, put them back in your bag, and keep going. Keep pressing in, keep fighting. And so sometimes the waiting for these seeds is so frustrating. So frustrating. But don't get annoyed, don't get frustrated. Press into God. And sometimes you need a little bit of tenacity in your career. You know, it's a bit of a fight going on. And sometimes you want that breakthrough so badly that you push, push, push. And so I want to encourage you today, you know, with these seeds of faith, sometimes it's a fight. Sometimes it's easy. And you never know what seeds you plant and what's going to be what. But you just believe and you do not give up. You hold on. Because if God gives you those dreams, they're God dreams, hold on to them. And if God, sometimes he might show you other things and different things. And in those 5 years, I'm not saying that God didn't answer any of my prayers. I'm not saying that I was miserable. Because I've been reaping. And we've been putting seeds in a whole lot of things. So we were reaping other things, just not that particular seed. Not that stubborn one right there. You know, that one there was a fight. These ones kept coming. So sometimes some things are a fight. A fight in faith. And the funny thing is, with that one for me, I can pray for people to have children, and I have the utmost faith in my God, because I have won that battle. So for me, I have won that battle. And so I've prayed for people who can't have children, so isn't it? And I've won that battle, so I have that faith for you. It's like our family who put he had the faith and prayed and asked for us. I can do that for other people. And you'll find different things you've gone through, you will have that too. These things that you've won and need to fight, and you get there, you can pull people up because your faith never dies. You just go, yeah, we can do this, we can do that. Pull people up with you. So I just want to encourage you to sometimes the waiting seems like a long time, but trust in God. And how good is it, you know? How good is God? And I just love it. And Elijah being the Lord is my God is just so cool for Nick and I. And we look at him and like, it still puts a smile on our face. How good God is to us. That's awesome. And then we stop, and then we, you know, we such a fight for one, and then we have Kieran and it's like, oh God, you're awesome, you know, so cool. So John 15, verse 5-8. Yes, I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who remain in me, and in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me is thrown like away like useless branches of wither. Such branches are gathered into a pile to be burned. But if you remain in me and my words remain in you, you may ask for anything you want and it will be granted. The vine and the branches. How many times do you hear this? And you know, if anyone's like me, I'm a bit of a picture girl. And has anyone seen the picture of Jesus knocking on the door? You know, like those pictures in the book. And there's always a vine, have you noticed that? Around the door. Anyone? Was that just me? Is he remember the vine? Oh, there's more than me out there. You know, this vine was grown all over the Palestine, as it still is. And it is a plant which needs a great deal of attention. It's not a weed. It's not one that just pops up and everyone feels like it. And if the best fruit to get out of it, it needs the most attention. It is grown commonly on terraces, and the ground has to be perfectly clean. There has to be work done. That soil has to be prepared. It's sometimes trained on trellises, it is sometimes allowed to creep over the ground, upheld by low forked sticks. It sometimes even grows around the doors of the cottages, and that's the pictures I see. But wherever it grows, careful preparation of the soil is essential. When we plant seeds with God, it's not just a wish list, it's not just a throw in the sky, let's scatter where it lands. Like Nick said, we're going to plant intentionally this year. So let's get the soil right. Let's get the time ready for harvest right. And it grows abundantly, and drastic pruning is necessary. drastically back to develop and conserve its life and energy. Some things can't go too big, too fast, because you can't sustain it. When mature, see that, oh, mature, we've finally made it. No. This vine, it gets pruned in December and January. How close are those together? It's not even like once a year, you can handle that, not December and January. It bears two kinds of branches, one that bears fruit and one that does not. And the branches that do not bear fruit are drastically pruned back so they will not drain away any of the plant strength. The vine cannot produce the crop of which it is capable without drastic pruning. And Jesus said this when he talks about the vine and the branches. Drastic. Radical. Extreme. Severe. Harsh. Pruning. Yes! How much fun does that sound like? That's exciting stuff. I just want to approach it, that's all I want. Sorry. Now, none of this sounds smart, does it? To grow abundantly equals drastic pruning. When mature, you get pruned twice within 2 months. At least then, I suppose you've got 10 months to recover. And the branches that do not bear fruit are drastically pruned back, so they will not drain away none of the plant's strength. The vine cannot produce a crop for which it is capable without this pruning. So think about your life. What's in there that we need to prune out? What's there that's taking the life out of us? And so we don't have the energy for what God has intended. What is there? What do we need to do about it? Furthermore, the wood of the vine has a curious characteristic that is good for nothing. It is soft, so you can't do any more with it. At certain times of the year, it was laid down by the law that people must bring offerings of wood to the temple for the altar fires. And guess what? The wood of the vine must not be bought. The only thing that could be done with this wood that was pruned off was a bonfire and destroy it. It was worth nothing. It was useless. It was like, don't take it to God's altar, because you can't use it for anything. That's not what it's about. It's just put it to the side and burn. And I was thinking about that, because we got a fireplace for it, I'm going to put it in, 3 years ago, maybe. And everywhere we go, Nick's like, I see firewood. And I'm just like, oh, for goodness sake. We're driving to Auckland. Have you seen like our farms in the paddocks just have those massive big piles? And it's like, I need a trailer. And I was like, oh, for goodness sake. Because if we cut it all up to put it anyway, but it's just now it's a joke. So now wherever we go, we just put the firewood being silly. And I'm sure we're not the only people that do that. But those farmers, how they just leave it there, that's just a bonfire. It's good for nothing. You know, it's too much work or too much energy to move it. They just burn it. These vines that we cut off our lives, they're not something that then we're going to go and spend the time and energy to pick it back up, take it somewhere and do something with it. Because it's rubbish. It just burn it. You know, it's worth nothing in your life. And don't let it distract you. And that's what I got out of it. It's like some things that we need to cut off and just get rid of. And the dead vine we're carrying our lives are destroying us or hindering us to move forward and live our lives as God's intended. He says that his followers are like this. Some of them are lovely fruit-bearing branches of himself. Others are useless because they bear no fruit. It's all very depressing, isn't it? Sorry. But there are three ways which we can be useless branches. So these are the things we're not going to be. We can refuse to listen to Jesus Christ at all. Well, we're all at church, so we're all expecting to hear from God, aren't we? We can listen to him and then render him a lip service, unsupported by any deeds. So you can turn up on a Sunday, you know, the talk, you know, what you're supposed to say, you know it all, but then you go out of church and then, whoa, what is going on there? You know, no one would look at you and think that you're a Christian. And, you know, people are watching. It's really quite funny. And sometimes you don't even realise that people are watching. And this week, I'm in an office making a little report, and I'm just at my desk doing my own thing, keeping my mouth quiet, which is quite impressive this particular day. And the guy just finished his report on the outside of the office, and he comes up and he goes, oh, Kylie, I must just tell you, he's just got into this 12-hour night. He's like, we were talking about you last night. And I said, oh, that's great. I love when people talk about me. And he's like, no, it was all good. I'm like, oh, they're even better. And stuff. And he goes, you know, I heard last night that you, and he puts me like this, I shouldn't laugh, I didn't laugh. He goes, that you made an awesome pastor's wife like this. And I go, and so, you know me, how humble I am. And I go, and why would that surprise you? Like, and he just cracks up laughing. He goes, I knew you'd say something like that. And I'm like, so who was it? Who's saying this about me? He goes, oh no, they sworn me to secrecy, but they said that you were really, really good at it. And I'm just like, I went home to Nick, I'm like, what does that mean? Like, what is that title? And stuff. And I'm just like, how funny is that? But it's just that people talk. You want it to be good things, don't you? You want it to be positive. You know what people are talking just about, oh, she goes to church on a Sunday, but you can't tell her work, can you? You know, you don't want that. And the other thing is, you get tested in the little things. And this week, I couldn't put it down to a blessing of God, but they'll be twisting the truth. And I met a girlfriend, and we went out for coffee, which we do. And I don't know why, but this particular time we sat down at the table and they came and took our order. And said, if you normally order your coffee, you pay, sit down. So they took our order, that's fine, we sit there for an hour chatting. And then as we left the cab, we both said thank you very much and goodbye. And said goodbye to them, walked out, thought nothing of it. And it was great catching up with his girlfriend. It wasn't until 2 hours later that I get a text from her. OMG. We didn't pay for our coffee. And I'm like, no way, that is awesome. And so I bring it up. I'm like, that is so cool. The fact that we even smiled and said goodbye and didn't pay, that's just wicked, you know. And we're laughing and laughing, and she doesn't know what we're doing. I'm like, well, where are you? I'm at home, but I'll go down and pay for it. Wasn't even a split thought that, oh, that's a free coffee. Oh, thank you, Jesus, for my free coffee. No, it's stealing. You know, she's like, no, I'm not in town still. I'll go straight back, apologise and pay. My ass, like, yes. So she went back and paid for it. But you get tested in the little things. Things like that. Turn around, go back, make it right. It's not hard. Most people laugh if you turn up and you haven't paid, but, oh, we were cracking up. But I can't believe that we even just waved goodbye and didn't say anything. But, you know, you get tested in the little, because what you are honest with the little, you get given much. It's all the little things that count. So these little things make him right with God. 3, we accept him as master, and in the face of difficulties, on the way, or the desires of doing what we like, we abandon him. There's another way that we can be a useless branch. One thing we must remember is the first principle of the New Testament, that ineffectiveness invites disaster. The fruitless branch is on the way to destruction. Sometimes we need to cut off that branch before it spreads to the whole tree. And allow God to prune us, accept some home truths, deal with them, and stay connected. No vine on its own without having roots in the ground can survive. So let's get planted in the house of God. And sometimes God will show us things, God will teach us things, and sometimes it hurts. Sometimes it's not easy, sometimes it's uncomfortable. But we abide in Christ. It's not so much about what we do for Christ, but what he does in and through us. We must keep contact with Jesus. We cannot do that unless we deliberately take steps to do it. Pray in the morning. Even if it's only for a few moments, set the mood for the day. Abiding in Christ will mean a constant contact with him. It will mean arranging life, arranging prayer, arranging silence in such a way that there is never a day when we can give ourselves a chance to forget him. Make time your day for God, even 5 minutes. Put down Facebook 5 minutes and you'll so much more will come to your life. There are 2 things laid down about the good disciple. First, he enriches his own life. His contact makes him fruitful with God's coming with God. Secondly, he brings glory to God. The sight of his life turns men's thoughts to God, who made him like that. Sometimes you need to do things throughout your day, you just mind your own business, and it makes people think of God. How cool is that? Well, some people, you're surprised, they'll come up to you and they've got a need and ask you to pray, because you're the light of the world. God is glorified, and when we can bear much fruit and show ourselves to the disciples, of Jesus, the greatest glory to the Christian life, is that by our life and conduct, we bring glory to God. At the end of the day, that is what we want. We want to be able to bring glory to God. Let us be productive, godly people. Disciplined life is a productive life. Unfortunately, these two go together. Discipline is important in every aspect of our life. In order to be successful and free, and allows one to have power and control of their life, a disciplined person is free of the chaos that people without this skill experience. It's interesting, isn't it, that a disciplined life will make you free. A disciplined person adheres to and abides by certain rules and norms. And the thing is, that sometimes it's hard to actually discipline yourself, and sometimes it's hard to motivate yourself, but that's why you need to get into God and ask Him to help you. The children with bedtime, who knows that if they go to bed late, they are so useless the next morning. You can't get them to do anything, you know? Get them, you discipline, you try and get them to bed, and then it's easier the next day for everybody. Or what about the people that are gaming all night? You're so tired the next day at work, you can't concentrate. We've got to get discipline around these sorts of things. Or staying up to watch the last of a movie. I'm guilty of that one. And you know, you just got to see the end. But then the next day, you're not as productive as what you should be. And sometimes we need to put these disciplines around ourselves just so then we can be more effective and do what we're supposed to be doing. And now Proverbs 10:17. People who accept discipline are on the pathway to life, but those who ignore correction will go astray. The thing is that God places people of authority in your life at certain times. And if you know that God's placed you there, then sometimes the truth hurts. Sometimes someone might say something to you, and it'll be in love, and it'll be in respect, but sometimes it's not exactly what you want to hear. But sometimes, this is just God doing a little bit of pruning. Sometimes it's just God helping you out. But it's not going to be someone that you don't have any respect for. It's not going to be somebody, just anybody. Because you don't just let anybody and everybody talk into your life. Because if you're going to be working in the Spirit of God, you're going to have discernment. And so sometimes we need to be switched on and ask God, you know, sometimes you'll be thinking of things, like even I'm saying about the branches and things that need to be pruning. There'll be something just rattling over in your brain, but you're like, God, I need more than that, God. Give me something else. And you'll be surprised at what comes across your path, or what you see, to know, okay, I need to do it. And you know, like in that verse, I wasn't going to share it, because I'm like, discipline. Who loves discipline? I don't. You know? And do you know that scripture verse came out 5 times on my Instagram feed yesterday? 5 times. I'm like, okay,
I'm going to talk about discipline.
You know, because otherwise I'll get disappointed. But, you know, the thing is that it's not comfortable. But, like, Nick and I, we've got oversight, we've got pastors, we've had things in the past, we've had people come to us, you know, senior pastors that obviously we look after us, and say different things. Well, we do what they say, because it's all about chain of blessing, chain of command. And that's what it is, you know. And I was reading something. If you want to come up, sure. Gene Johnson, who was a singer for Bethel, just random, so you know, wrote this, and I thought about it because obviously I'm in a leadership position in my work as well, and so sometimes for the decisions I make, I get flagged for. And anyone that is in any management position, any leadership position, will know that people make judgments on your calls. And she wrote this, which I thought was really interesting, so I'm going to share it with you. When leaders, church, work, or political, because everyone can talk about political stuff as well, I find it so boring to be honest, make decisions, more often than not, it is based on the information that the people they are leading can or will ever know. I used to question leaders, then I became one, and felt the weight of having to make those hard decisions, knowing I would be criticised, but ultimately knowing before God, it was the best thing I could do for the whole, for all the people I was leading. Before you criticize or you think you know better than any leaders, stop and think. You know what? I don't know all the details, so although I might not agree with the choices, I will not be arrogant and I will choose to believe there is more going on that cause them to make that decision that I understand, then pray. How cool is that? You know, sometimes people make decisions, even for me at work, and you're just like, seriously, why would you do that? Why? And then I'm just like, I read that and I'm like, well, who am I to question? They are the people in that position in the hospital, that's their choice, their decision. What's my job? Pray. And if it's nothing illegal, then I'll do what I'm told with the state and my boss. You know what I mean? Like, they are the ones that tell me to jump, I jump, woo! You know, but that's what I do, and I do it with a smile. And the thing is, like, I can be so stressed, I can so disagree with what they're saying. And the funny thing is, the people that know me, they call me possum eyes. Because apparently they can tell if I'm like not impressed, but I'll do it. Because my eyes go quite big. And so, but they know that I will do it, because that's what I've been told. And that, ultimately, is their decision, not mine. But I'll pray about it. And I'll pray that I have the right motive. I pray that I have them making the right call and the right decision at the right time. Because how many know the right decision at the wrong time is the wrong decision? So if that's where we want to just be in line with Christ and just put that even 5 minutes at the start of your day. So then you're walking in the direction and then you've got that conversation going and you've got just little things triggering and you just know that you're walking in the right step. Because who wants to walk in the right seat every day? It's way easier to walk around puddles and through them, isn't it? Unless you keep them, he loves puddles. So, you know, let's try and be godly disciples. Let's try and live how he wants us to live. And I've just got one quote as when it comes up. Talent without discipline is like an octopus on roller skates. There's plenty of movement, but you never know if it's going to be going forward, backwards, or sideways. God empowers us for purpose. Let's abide in him and we can be the best we can be. Thank you.
Today, who's never made a decision to follow Jesus. You've never got connected with him. You've never learned what it is to remain in him and be connected to that vine. And I want to give you an opportunity to do that. Or maybe you've done that. You've drifted away from that. And you say, hey, this morning, I want to go to get my relationship right with God. I've got to get every head bowed for just a moment. And if there's anybody here who's in that place, you say, hey, man, I need to do that. I need to get my life right. I need to get connected with Jesus again. I need to get into that place of relationship with him. Can I get you to slip your hand in here so I can see it? Is there anybody here this morning? You say, hey, that's me. I need to get connected with God. Yeah, fantastic. Yeah, fantastic. Is there anybody else? Yeah, cool. Anybody else? Anybody down the back there? You're thinking, man, I need to do this. I need to get connected with myself. First time, second time, tenth time. Doesn't really matter. God's interested more in your connection, not when you drifted away. Is there anybody here? Anybody else? You say, man, it's me. I want to get connected again with God. Get my relationship right with him. Get back in connection. Nobody else? Just one more moment as we bring it to a close. You may have done this before. You may have drifted away from it. Is there anybody else? Nobody else? Fantastic. How do I pray for those three people? Can we all stand to our feet? I'd just like to invite those three people to raise their hands. Come out the front and pray with you. And just give them a hand as they come to us. Fantastic. Hey, how you doing? Stand over here. Can you just face me so you don't feel like all your eyeballs hanging there? How tall are you, man? 6'4", stop running. Yeah. Thanks. That's awesome, man. What's that? Rich. Rich. Yeah, I'm on top of it. Yeah. Come on. I've never met anybody from Bridge before. Fantastic. How you doing?
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm nervous.
I'm sorry.
That's awesome. Hey, Daniel. So good. So good. Yeah. Come on. You're always here. Come on. Love that. Gotta love that. Who's gonna pray for it? Okay, I'm gonna pray for it. Have you done this before? Never done it the first time? Have you been in church this time? Yeah, just so you kind of get what's going on. Yeah, cool. What I'm going to do right now, I'm going to pray a prayer. and I'll get you to pray after them. This prayer invites Jesus into your world and making you Lord. Okay, so I'll make it really easy, but I'll get everybody in the room to pray with you so that I'm there to pray alone as this happens. Fantastic. Let's just pray. Dear Jesus, I ask you to come into my world.
I ask you to come into my world.
I ask you to forgive me.
I ask you to forgive me.
And to cleanse me.
And to cleanse me.
Of anything I've done wrong.
Of anything I've done wrong.
I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus.
That you died on the cross for me.
That you died on the cross for me.
So that I might have life.
So that I might have life.
And I thank you, Lord.
I thank you, Lord.
That I'm saved.
That I'm saved.
That I'm going to heaven.
That I'm going to heaven.
And that I'm in your family.
And I'm in your family.
Father, just pray right now for Rich. Lord, make the first time decision for you. Father, just pray to touch him. Father, with your seal of God, the Holy Spirit, this covenant, this deal, this contract that he's just made with him, Father, it'll be solid in his world. Father, never be the same again, this man, because he's been met with the King of all kings, in Jesus' name. Father, the jazz, Lord, just pray to your touch. And Lord, you're filled with the Holy Spirit, Father. Lord, there's a heart in here that just wants to go for you, Father. We pray that you grab that. We grab it and just keep drawing it yourself, Father. She'd know the life that she can have with you in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, Father, can you Lord, we'll touch you. Father, again, by the power of the Holy Spirit, Father, we'll touch it. Seal it with love and Lord, this covenant relationship that you have with her in Jesus' name. And everybody see it.
Amen.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Kathy's just getting something to stand with you. This is going to give a couple of details off you if that's cool, and just give you a little book and something like that just to keep you up to date with what's going on. So if you just want to follow Kathy over here, she can get that to you. Fantastic, that's so good. Let's give this guy another hand. So good. I'm going to say that I love that moment. Hey, that was fantastic. You guys are awesome today. Hey, we've got coffee downstairs and stuff. Don't forget to check us out for season conference. We want to get all those people locked in for that and money through and et cetera, et cetera. And after that, you have